We have a great history. Isn't that so, leaders? We have a great history. Yes. And I want to share a little about our history. Our history says that Christopher Columbus came here and he discovered Guyana. But we were here already. We were here already. And we are proud because our ancestors were here. Just recently, our history got corrupt or something, and it was twisted. But today I want to let you know that the first peoples of this beautiful country can assemble here under one roof with our government to address our issues. I think you should put your hands together for our government. Mr. Chair, permit me please to make some brief remarks. And this has to do with land. For many years, the indigenous peoples of this land, we have land issues. And we cannot run away from that. But I believe that this is a time when the leaders can sit with His Excellency and His government to talk about land issues. We have the ALT project. And under the ALT project, started under the former administration. And I would like to say, they have done some work, but more things can be done, could be done then, to address land issues for the indigenous people. There are still issues that are burning within the indigenous peoples of this country. When I go into the hinterlands and I visit them, they would say to show Joel, what is happening with this issue, or land? And I would go and visit and see the conditions that my people are living in, and the land issues, and the pollution, and the mining. It grieves my heart as a leader. I want to say to His Excellency, let us look, as the chairman of the NPC, how we can work together in addressing the land issues for our indigenous people in Guyana. I am a leader who believes in negotiation, talking together, looking at the issue and finding solutions to address it. I believe that is the way forward. We have mining issues, and I can recall clearly in 2012, under the leader of the opposition now, right here in this conference room, titles were given to Tashirini and Kangaruma and taken back. We want to correct those things. I believe from then to now, we must find a way to correct these things, Mr. President. This is not time to play around with the indigenous people's life and their livelihood, but this is to address issues, people's future. I visit there a few months back under with the ALT team, and I was saddened within my heart. I believe at this conference we need to walk away with positive answers when it comes to land rights, land ownership for the indigenous people. Mr. President, the MTC is with you to address these matters. I would like to highlight the revision of the Amerindian Act. And I would like to say we are blessed to have a document, a law, for our indigenous people. But we recognize it needs strengthening. And NTC, with the government, we want a partnership and see how we can strengthen this document so that the indigenous peoples can be better off. They can have rights to their land, resources. They must feel comfortable. And the NTC would like to be the key player in the consultation of the Amerindian Act with this present administration, Mr. President. Because I'm a true believer of FPIC, and this is the demonstration of FPIC and true democracy. Mr. President, when I became chair of the National Toshaos Council, my expectations was high. Because I was aware of the Forest Carbon Partnership Facility Funds, FCPF. The NTC was informed that these funds are available at GFC. So my secretary and I, we went there and we find out. And we were told that, yes, the funds is here. And that funds, it was mainly to set up our secretariat. I went and I did make quotation, three quotations and all these things. My expectation was very high. And after that, I heard the funds went back. Mr. President, it seems to me that the MTC is running a marathon to find this FCPF funds to set up our secretariat. For the MTC to be effective and to serve the indigenous villages and peoples of this country, we need our own secretariat. Isn't that so, leader? No government must feel threatened if we get our own secretariat when we establish it. I believe in working together for one cause, for the betterment of our beautiful country. Mr. President, this project hasn't started as yet, and I would like to know why. Because when I go into the hinterlands, that is what my indigenous brothers and sisters ask me. Where is your secretary? What happened to the funds? Mr. President, the LCDS, the opt-in mechanism for indigenous communities to play an important role in climate change. We cannot run away that we are not facing global warming, climate change. And the indigenous peoples who have been preserving this beautiful country and the forests, we want to make our contribution, so we need answers to the opt-in mechanism. We want to be a part, nationally. The solar panels, we need lights. For our young people, Mr. President, I know that you love young people, children, because I'm proud of what you're doing for education. But I believe, because of the challenges I face as a child for education, that's my passion. And I believe with the NTC and your government, we can do more for the indigenous children of our hinterland.
Toshaos and senior councillors, most of you have traveled far distances from where you live to be here at the Toshaos Convention, International Convention Center this morning. You have braved the rainy weather and climbed your mountains when you could not ride. And I do not doubt that some of you had to swim across some very high creeks too. Not to mention negotiating miles of road that are in such terrible condition, especially at this time. But you are here, and that's what matters. Because now you can talk to the very hardworking and resourceful Minister of Infrastructure, the Honorable David Patterson, and the Minister within the Ministry of Infrastructure, the Honorable Annette Ferguson. Brothers and sisters, I will tell you a little secret. They are doing many fine works, but I noticed they like to build roads. The residents of Sophia said they want proper roads, and there went David and Annette in their long boots and tin helmet, and lo and behold, Sophia residents are getting roads. Vice President and I cried out for a proper road to the dormitory at William Dam, and guess what? We got a proper road, and we no longer feel as if we are going to let them in William Dam. But for those of you who have not seen our capital city for some time, you will definitely have the opportunity to feast your eyes on the wonderful works that have been done and are still ongoing to restore our capital city to the garden city it was years ago. It's only a little over a year, and your government, your government is here, but oh, what a delightful and healthy change for everyone. We can now breathe freely. Yes, as we promised before we entered government in 2015, we promised to bring change, and change is here. And you have already experienced one of the most significant changes since you arrived here in Georgetown. Freedom. Freedom to speak and make your own choices without fear. Last evening, you all met with the opposition members of Parliament, and today you're here to discuss the way forward. That did not happen before 2015, sadly say. The fact is, people were afraid to speak and be seen with us when we were in opposition, much less have a banquet with us, like we were leopards or something. Many of you who were brave enough to meet with us were branded as opposition then. You were told that only the previous government had all the answers for you, and that the opposition was something bad. And many of you believed that. But that is not so. The opposition is an important arm of the legislature. that works together with government on many occasions to pass legislation that will benefit you and the whole country. So we welcome your discussions with the opposition. They must understand all the issues of our First Peoples, because only then they will be able to support the many developmental plans that your government, with your input, will be implementing. Another major change is happening right now, in this very space. For the first time in history, in the history of the National Toshaos Conference, the National Toshaos Council is chairing the opening ceremony of the conference. Before one walks, one has to creep. And the NPC, from its inception in 2006, has been creeping. That's a long time to creep. It is time for you to stand and walk, my friends. But you have a caring government. And for 2 years in a stretch, 2015 and 2016, we have approved $65 million for each year for this conference to take place. Before, in 2013, $55 million was allocated. And in 2014, $58 million was allocated. Your government today has significantly increased the NTC purse by $10 million and $8 million. And our hardworking staff, headed by our PRDO, Anil Roberts, who calls himself your handyman for this conference, work tirelessly so that this conference can be a success. Your government will continue to support you financially and by holding your hands all the way, building your capacity while you learn to walk and become truly independent, having your own secretariat. It is absolutely necessary that our indigenous Guyanese be given the same opportunities that are available to our coastal brothers and sisters. So what if we live high over high mountains and raging creeks, over vast expanses of forests and savannas? Do we deserve less opportunity or no opportunity at all because we live so far? Our government says no! Indigenous Guyanese deserve the same opportunities because we are Guyanese. And living far away is just a consideration to factor into the planning. At last year's NPC, President David Granger unveiled your government's 10-point plan of action for the development of the hinterland, for your development. I am happy to say, Excellency, that there are lots of action in 106 hinterland communities in the 10 regions presently, since the Hinterland Employment and Youth Service has been rolled out in these communities.
I am happy to report that it was a good year. With all that you have heard, or all that you have experienced, all that you have seen, all that we have faced with El Nino and these floods, it is still a good year. We have made steady progress with the implementation of the 10-point plan as adumbrated by His Excellency President David Greenwood. The Hinterland Youth Employment Scheme is up and running, as you would have heard from my colleague minister within the ministry. Infrastructure works are ongoing, courtesy of the Ministry of Public Infrastructure. And again, you heard that before. And I just want to reinforce the truth in it. And the regional administration, in collaboration with central government, all these things are possible. The Hinterland Housing Program being undertaken by the Central Housing and Planning Authority is in its second phase. We are discussing a significant agricultural project with IFAD, which will benefit Regions 1 and 9 for a start. This project seeks to build upon the success of the Amerindian Development Fund project. And we are focusing on agriculture because, as I would say to many communities, if the stomach is filled, you're able to think about the other things that you need to have happen. But when it is empty, you think about filling it. And you look over at your neighbor and you see their chickens or their farm produce, and you could get into trouble with you. So we believe that agriculture, without the farmer, no one survives, or no one can survive. We're also pursuing an extension to the Amerindian land tightening project. We believe that the indigenous people's land issues are critical to nation building. We are certain that with an extension to the project, we will be able to address this matter in a very significant way. Contrary to what some will have you believe, your government continues to offer significant support to the sustainable development drive of the indigenous villages and communities all across Guyana. Each of you can attest to that fact independently. Villagers, however, continue to struggle with division, and the work of agents of division. Your struggle shall cause you to emerge triumphant in the very short term. Do not relent. I urge you all to accept the traditional ways and solutions will emerge. Is there work to be done? Yes, there is work to be done. Let us use the form of Kayap, Mayu, Manor, as it used to be when we were together. When we saw life as being meaningful to each and every one, even those other life forms that we relate to every day. Are there problems to be solved? Yes. Let us counsel by the fire with the elders. Of course, these approaches can only be possible where there is mutual respect. When we met here last year, we discussed the need for the strengthening of the Amerindian Act. When I spoke with the Executive Council at the first meeting, I said that I was minded to take Cabinet a menu of amendments to the Act for approval, then to present them to the National Assembly of the Parliament for passage into law. I had requested then that the Council submits to me within 2 weeks some written proposals for this purpose. I remain ready to work with you to strengthen the Amerindian Act. In this regard, I shall yet await your submission. I continue to be worried by the lack of respect shown for elected Toshaos in their various villages. I'm quite certain you are aware of what I'm speaking about. The same people who elected their leaders show scant regard to those leaders as they manage the day-to-day affairs of the villages. Likewise, disrespect by some Toshaos for the citizens of their villages is alarming. We cannot continue to operate in this manner if we are going to move, or if we want to have a good life. We have to listen, we have to pay attention to the needs. We are in position not to oppress, but to build upon the wishes of your people. There are village leaders who seek to use their elected office to their own self-interest and to the frustration of villagers. Rules which do not exist are enforced, and offenses which are not on the books are punished by penalties hitherto unheard of. I have been using the reconciliatory approach with limited success. We have seen to date that there are yet communities and leaders who seem bent on continuing to be ruthless in their way of doing business. But accountability for hard fund finances is critical if we are going to move forward. As minister, I shall work with you to ensure that all leaders abide with the law. It is my hope when I do, those who thrive on causing division will not seek mileage from my action. After all, leaders are but first among equals and must by example lead. Expelling counselors from meetings for disagreements with the official, threatening counselors with dismissal, making arbitrary decisions, and entering into agreement to exploit village resources without council or village approval cannot be allowed to continue. The NTC needs to take its responsibility seriously. And I'm saying this because I myself, when complaints come, I pass it on to the relevant ministries, minister, and they take action just to find out that most of the time it is the Toshao who was given permission without the knowledge of the council. And this is embarrassing. We have to desist from that sort of a practice. You are a Toshao. You are a leader for your people, and consultation must be the first step to a decision. Remember, we've just heard about EFIC, we heard it from the chairman of the NTC, and we need to have the best out of whatever is done, whatever agreement is made in for that community. Everyone must benefit from the action taken by a leader, as you as leader. You must ensure that your people are aware. Decision must be taken holistically. And I am so pleased that the NPC is working.